Manila's finance chief Benjamin Diokno says the Maharlika Investment Fund is making headway despite a legal challenge before the Supreme Court. Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel and former Bayan Muna Party List representatives filed a petition Monday asking the High Court to declare the Sovereign Wealth Fund unconstitutional. They argue the law is a disaster waiting to happen because it did not go through a test of economic viability. Diokno says government will first study the petition before issuing a response.
We will respond to the petition at the right time, in the right place. No? Pinag-aaralan na yan ng Office of the Solicitor General. Siya yung magiging abogado namin dyan. At saka yung mga ni-raise nila na issues na yan, na-raise na rin nila during the deliberation. Nag-iikot din kami sa buong mundo, in fact, kagagaling lang namin sa Middle East, para maingganyo nga na mag-invest doon sa Maharlika Investment. Pero we have more than 100 billion na. We have actually identified some 197 top priority projects. Mm. Napakalaking amount na kailangan ipundo natin. Kasama na dyan, of course, some of the ongoing projects katulad ng mga yung subway, mga train, etc., bridges linking one province to another. So, kailangan natin ng pera para doon.
No? Apo,
okay, so ang rate of return noon, at least 10% internal rate of return noon. Some project na yan, some will give 25% return, some 30%, 50%.
One of the petitioners, Bayan Muna Chairman, Attorney Nery Colmenares, now joins us here on the program. Attorney Colmenares, good afternoon to you. Thanks for joining us today and welcome to the program.
Hi, Carmina. Good afternoon po.
All right. Well, we just heard from Finance Secretary Benjamin Diokno right there, very confident still about the Maharlika Investment Fund. They're making headway, he says. He also says, in the tone of his voice, seems like as if he's really not bothered by the petition. In fact, he also said in that interview that they will not wait for the results of the petition. They're going to go ahead with their plans. Your thoughts on that, Attorney Colmenares?
We asked the Supreme Court, Carmina, to restrain the implementation of the Maharlika law because the Land Bank and the DBP already gave Maharlika about at least 75 billion pesos when Maharlika has not even told us who the board of directors are. Isn't it dangerous, for example, for public funds in the tune of 75 billion pesos to be given to a corporation that we don't even know the board of directors? If they will be coming from big corporations, wouldn't this endanger the funds to be used in cronyism or to favor certain companies because they have representatives in the board of directors? So we really hope that the Supreme Court will restrain the implementation of the Maharlika Fund, especially they admitted that this will take 5-6 years for us to gain. Mm. And Secretary Diokno said it's what, 25% rate of return. They didn't explain that and showed it in the economic viability test. I mean, the Senator Pimentel has been asking for a clear economic viability test from them to show how can they cope with inflation, how can they cope with recession worldwide. Mm. But they haven't really gone through that. So that's one of the reasons why we went to the Supreme Court, because the government should not be spending 500 billion pesos at least on a corporation in the midst of inflation, in the midst of rising prices, in rise in gas and other commodities, Carmina.
Now, Attorney Colmenares, you're not just questioning the provisions of the Maharlika Investment Fund. In fact, you're going back to how it was even enacted. What was wrong in the manner by which the Maharlika Investment Act was enacted? What was constitutional or make that unconstitutional to your mind about the whole process, Attorney Colmenares?
One of the constitutional grounds we raise in the petition is that it violated the constitutional requirement that all bills, before it becomes law, should pass three readings in three separate days with a printed copy of the bill being approved, distributed to the members of the House and the Senate. They did not undergo that process because the bill was certified urgent, certification of emergency by President Marcos. Mm. Was there an emergency? Magugunaw bang mundo pag hindi maaprubahan ang Maharlika that very day? No. That was a business certification and only short-circuited the legislative processes in both the House and the Senate. Ngayon, minadali nila. They found so many mistakes in the bills because they rushed it. They changed it, Carmina. How can you change a bill already approved on third reading in violation of the Constitution when the session in Congress has already been suspended sine die? Mm-hmm. I mean, they're on recess. So only Congress can amend the bill that they have passed on third reading, and no number of senators, without convening the Congress as a whole, can amend a bill already approved on third reading. So those are the questions that we are filing. In fact, Carmina, if there's really an emergency, the House bill was certified in December of 2022. So, but there was no certification in the Senate. So, I mean, if there's really an emergency that we need to certify a law immediately, they should have certified it in the Senate. And secondly, after the Senate passed it on May 31 of 2023, it took them 2 months to submit it to the president. That's why we allege that they were still amending the bill and studying how to amend it during the time, because there was no rush to have the bill signed by the president. And so all these things together showed that the bill did not follow the legislative process as a rule required in the Constitution, and rather they went to the exception wherein the president may certify it urgent, but there was no emergency, there was no calamity, and therefore the short-circuiting of legislative process is unconstitutional.
Here's the thing, Attorney Colmenares, all the things that you've raised just now were raised even before. This is nothing new. In fact, Secretary Benjamin Diokno himself has said that all of these were raised as well during the deliberations. Your defense to that point being made by Secretary Diokno?
And they were not answered, Carmina. We've been asking for the economic viability test. They never gave that. They gave a business proposal. We've always told, well, they did the amendments to the bill after the Congress is in recess. So there's no way it could have been tackled in the deliberation, as Secretary Diokno said. I mean, it only happened after the Congress is in recess. So it wasn't really tackled. So that's not really true. We only raised it after it was passed on third reading, because we heard that there are amendments through Viber, that they're changing it, and there were media statements, public statements by the leadership of both houses of Congress that they're revising the third reading copy of the bill. So I don't think it should be allowed, because otherwise, every time we pass a bill, any Tom, Dick, and Harry can just amend it to the detriment of the legislative process and, of course, the Filipino people, because we will be saddled with laws that were not really approved essentially by both houses of Congress as required by the Constitution.
Talk to us about the sense of urgency here that's needed from the Supreme Court as they act on this petition, Attorney Colmenares. I mean, you already heard Secretary Diokno, and you've seen a lot of our economic managers, the president himself, really selling this Maharlika Investment Fund each and every time they travel abroad. They're promoting the MIF. And now you're questioning it. And now you're asking the Supreme Court to restrain or at least put a stop temporarily, if not permanently, on this. Talk to us about how this action should take place now from the Supreme Court, but also conversely, what face will the government show to all the audiences that they presented to if and when the Supreme Court grants your petition, sides with you? They already sold or attempted to sell the MIF to the international audience. Attorney Colmenares.
We don't know, Carmina, how the Supreme Court will decide. I'm just sharing the content of our petition. But with regards to what the face of the investment, I mean, I commiserate with them if they keep assuring the investors and here comes this petition. If it is their money, Carmina, 500 billion pesos, I have no problem with that. But we're talking of public funds. These are funds needed by the Filipino people today. In light of all these problems that you've actually just said that in the news a few minutes ago. Mm. So because of that importance, in the end, I don't really care what face they will show to the investors, because we've been telling them this is a 500 billion peso project. Have it scrutinized, have it studied, especially by independent experts and experts in both houses of Congress. But they refused. In fact, they transgressed the three reading rules, rushing the bill on the basis of a baseless certification of emergency. And that's their fault, I think. Mm-hmm. If they only allowed the normal legislative process to have been conducted, and then it would have been studied, and they are able to assure all of us. And I mean, I'm open to any isip. Ako naman kung tama, tama. Kung mali, mali, di ba?
Basta klaro.
Basta klaro. Walang klaro eh. And for me, Land Bank and DBP should not have transferred 75 billion pesos of their pondo. And we would like to inquire from Land Bank and DBP. Were depositors' money transferred to Maharlika? These are depositors. These are government employees. Their sueldo is in Land Bank. So they transferred without even knowing who the board that will manage these billions of pesos are. I mean, who fund managers are? Who will decide on the investment? Mm. I mean, that's really, for me, an abuse of discretion on the part of both banks to spend or to risk the money of the bank itself, which are public funds, or the depositors themselves in such a very risky undertaking. And managers, as of now, until now, despite the statement of the government that they're moving ahead, they haven't even identified to us the managers of this fund.
Attorney Colmenares, connect the two for us. Because on one hand, you have the fate of this MIF, right? On the other, you have the fate and the reality of the Filipino people. To some, it's so far, this discussion about the MIF, it's so far from the gut. Talk to us about the connection here as to why people should care about how this is run, the fate of the MIF. Talk to us about that, Attorney Colmenares.
Well, we have deficit always. Every time people ask for funding for social pension for the elderly, ayuda for the fish in Mindoro, ayuda for the grew under very extreme prices of gas, the government says there are no funds, and yet they have 500 billion. That is the gut, Carmina. It will impact on social services. It will impact on education, health, because these funds could be spent on them sana if they really want to. But they would rather risk it in an investment scheme called Maharlika that we are not aware what the government is doing. Carmina, sovereign wealth funds are not advisable in countries that are plagued with corruption. I mean, it's really difficult to put public funds in a corporation that is essentially run by private individuals, in a sense, because this is risky. Mm. So for me, I think people should feel that this is our money. We should have gone to education, we should have gone to health and social services and ayuda, which the government is now risking in the interest of this Maharlika Investment Corporation.
Well, talking about the funds that should have gone to social services and all the other things that are needed by the people now, let's talk about the transfer of funds from the Office of the President to the Office of the Vice President. Any thoughts on that? And should the very existence of CIFs actually be questioned and cleared and clarified as well before the Supreme Court, Attorney Colmenares?
With regards to the explanation of what about these confidential funds, there are now three versions, Carmina. I mean, when a secretary or Vice President Duterte mentioned, oh, confidential, national security, you know, in education, there are insurgents, so on. And then comes Executive Secretary Bersamin. They're spent on new programs for satellite offices of the Vice President. And here comes now the DBM saying, well, actually, they were spent for hospital benefits, medical benefits, for the travels of Vice President Duterte and other engagement international and here. Then what's the truth? These are public funds. So The question now is this. The contingent fund was transferred to the OVP confidential fund. These are contingent funds, Carmina, are regular budgetary items. They're supposed to undergo audit, regular audit by mm-hmm. COA. You transfer it to a confidential fund, which is not regularly audited. That's really useful for me. If we allow that kind of a transfer, then all public officials, all they have to do is they still transfer regularly audited items to a confidential fund and say, oh, well, it's confidential now. So the challenge to the government is this, and to Vice President Duterte, show us the receipt, show us the documents of payment as required by the joint circular on confidential funds. The DBM is tasked to explain, how did you transfer this from an existing item to a non-existing item in the budget? So it's really unexplainable for me. And COA, I'd like to put to task COA too. If there are stolen funds in regularly audited public funds in government, how much more with this not regularly audited? I haven't seen COA have a notice of disallowance or a special audit mentioning what irregularities were committed in the intelligence fund. And COA should not say, well, they're confidential. No, if that's an irregularity, COA is duty-bound to tell the public and both houses of Congress that there were irregularities here. The top officials cannot hide behind confidential funds for corruption. So all these things, Carmina, will probably lead to the Supreme Court someday for clarification, so that the Supreme Court can at least put a stop to this obsession of civilian agencies to have confidential funds when they don't even know how to use it, because that's not their mandate and that's not their expertise, instead of giving these confidential funds to security, to the investigative bodies of government.
Because basically what happened there, Attorney Colmenares, is that they opened the floodgates straight to a black hole. And we can't trace it if it's a black hole. I do want to touch on one other issue, a developing story. We continue to follow this. In fact, we're going to have another interview after you. That press conference of the NTF-LCAC presenting what they claimed were surrenderers. We're talking about Jonila and Jed, the environmentalists who went missing September 2nd, only for the press conference to be cut short after Jonila Castro claimed that they were actually abducted. Your thoughts on that?
Well, basically, there are liabilities now on the part of the military. The parents were looking for the two kids, and the military said, oh, we don't have them. Is that a violation of any law? Yes, the anti-enforced disappearance law essentially says that government or the military security sector has to certify to whoever is looking for a disappeared that they are not in their custody. So that's already a false certification in violation of the anti-enforced disappearance law. The second is, oh no, this is abduction now. And there will be criminal cases, there should be criminal cases filed against the military people who presented the two in the press conference, and the superiors of these military officers and those who denied the custody of the two girls during the time when their parents were searching. That's very clear in our laws, especially the anti-enforced disappearance law, mm-hmm. of which I was one of the authors, by the way, mm-hmm. together with Ed Selagman and Erin Tanyada. We authored those laws, and we hope that it should be performed and fulfilled by the government. By these developments.
All right. As we speak, Attorney Colmenares, I think members of the Kalikasan People's Network for the Environment, they're on their way to Bulacan, hopefully, to pick up the two girls. Your appeal towards the release of these girls?
I appeal to the military, of course, to allow the girls to go home to their families. That's the least they can do now. And secondly, I hope that there are a lot of human rights advocates who will go to Bulacan now and go to the military and get the girls, because I fear for their safety and their lives now that they have admitted in front of the media that they were abducted and the military was just, you know, making a false claim with regards to their supposed surrenders. I'm also appealing to the media, please do not leave the place. Please try to make sure that you see them and ask the military about their whereabouts, because now, because of this development, I'm really fearful that something could happen to them because of this turn of events. And the NTF, LCAC, and the military presented them. That was a press conference. At the moment it doesn't go according to your wishes, you shouldn't cut the press conference. The media and the girls have the right to air what happened to them, and the media have the right to ask questions rather than be cut abruptly merely because the lies of the military was exposed.
We're going to have to leave it at that. Attorney Nery Colmenares there, Chairman of Bayan Muna. Nice to see you again, Nery. Take care and you keep safe.
Thank you.